All right.
In a best of seven series between Boston and Brooklyn, blank will come out on top because of what?
Oh, boy.
Yeah. No pressure. No pressure.
None.
All the Celtics fans are listening.
Yeah, I was just curious. Like, do I get paid extra for pandering to the home audience?
Or? The Celtics will write you a check. We won't.
Man, I could go round and round on this one because if you asked me who I was more confident would be poised under pressure if this goes to a game seven or there's a critical overtime in a game five between these two teams, Kevin Durant has been there, done that, seen it all, and can get off any shot, anytime, anywhere against any defender. And that's hard to replicate. And Kyrie Irving, for all of his faults that you guys are maybe aware of, hit one of the biggest shots in NBA Finals history. Yeah. Now, James Harden's postseason record is a little less distinguished.
Yeah. But now he's with a team that can help him.
I exactly. love how you refer to it as less distinguished.
Right. That was so kind.
I'm absolutely stealing that, Howard. I'm just going to tell you.
I'm a middle child. I'm forever the diplomat. I just think that when you have two guys in Durant and Kyrie, and Durant in particular, there's no doubt about what those guys' ability to perform in the tightest, toughest, most dramatic moments. And so that matters. The Celtics on balance are still a little bit younger and less experienced at that level. So there's that. Defensively, I think the Celtics probably have the advantage off the top in large part because Jason and Jalen both can defend multiple positions and are committed and actually interested in that side of the game. And you've got Marcus Smart. So the perimeter D across those three, I think is really enviable. The Nets don't have that. Kevin Durant at his best is an elite defender or has been. Can he do that at this level still post Achilles? Can he do that over the course of the rest of this season and through the playoffs? We'll see. Kyrie Irving and James Harden, a little less distinguished at that side of the court. So they gave up Jared Allen in that deal for Harden. They gave up Caris LeVert. So they lost some really important defenders. They lost a lot of depth. I'm curious to see what Sean Marks does, whether it's before the trade deadline or maybe in the buyout market, what else he can unearth to kind of backfill the roster, because they have literal and figurative gaps in that rotation. And so I have less confidence in them overall. So I'm going to lean Celtics at this stage because of defense and because of just more of the continuity that they've had.
Wow. Wow.
Wait, but with that being said, what gaps would you fill in for Boston?
Ooh. Like the Nets, they could certainly use, someone to shore up the center spot. Although, Thompson and Tice, I mean, they'll patch it up okay. I think we don't know really how concerned yet to be about Kemba in the long term, right? Like, that knee injury has been going on a long time. He's back now. How is he going to be fine for the duration? How often is that going to flare up? How often is it going to limit him? How confident are you in Jeff Teague? So, those are the spotlights. It's funny, like with both teams, the places where you're really not concerned at all is at the swing positions. That's where you're feeling like both teams really have that strength and that versatility.
Yeah, I agree with pretty much everything Howard said. The big thing about the Nets is, and you touched on this, Howard, is their defense, man. It's horrible. I just don't see how they're going to significantly upgrade that in the short term. And I think in a best of seven series, offense is going to take you far in the playoffs, but at the end of the day, you got to get stops. And I worry about that with Brooklyn, because I think they've got more than enough firepower to be anyone and everyone in the NBA. But I think the fact that the Celtics have, I guess the best way to describe it, a better distinguished group on the defensive end of the floor, particularly at the wing positions, they have the ability to impact the game at both ends of the floor. When you look at the stats, like something like second chance points, for example, and you start looking at the players who are on the floor who give up a lot of those, three of the top four or five players in the NBA in most second chance points given up play for the Brooklyn Nets. And we don't have to go far to figure out who those three guys are. So statistically speaking, their defense doesn't really cut it. And the fact that they lost the one, I think, decent rim protector they had, they had to trade him away. I'm and they don't and you and they're arguably their best perimeter defender. there's a lot of concerns about what this team is going to do in crunch time from the defensive standpoint. And that, to me, more than anything else, is why in a best of seven series, I got to lean a little bit towards the Celtics because of the defensive dynamic.
Yeah, I will say this, though I did lean Celtics. The case for the Nets is they're unguardable. Mm-hmm. And if those three are in perfect sync with each other,
they're just going to
absolutely wreck your defense, mm-hmm. because you can't give any of those three guys any room whatsoever to operate, or they're going to score on you. And all three of them are just killer scorers. Mm-hmm. And, Harden, without as much of a burden on him, he probably will perform a lot better in this postseason with the Nets than he had in the years with the Rockets, where maybe he didn't feel like he couldn't take a single play off. You know, he can just sit there lying in the weeds waiting to strike now. So they're incredibly dangerous. But yeah, at some point, if you're just going to get in a shootout, okay, well, then the first team to make a stop wins. Can the Nets make that critical stop?